Hi guys, my name is Rocky and welcome sa last part ng ating video, the overview of object-oriented programming. Salamat at nakarating ka sa video nito. Kung bago ka pa lamang dito, ay pakiclick ang subscribe button at notification bell para ma-inform ka sa mga susunod pang video. Kung hindi mo naman napanood ang first at saka second part ng ating lesson, ay nag-iwan ako ng link dyan sa baba para mapanood ang mga ito. So, let's jump onto my PC. So, this is the last part of our lesson in overview of object-oriented, which is the characteristics of OOP. So, we will learn about the core of OOP in this video. In this video, we are going to look at some fundamental concepts and terms common to all OOP languages. Do not worry about how these concepts get implemented in any particular programming language that will come later. Our goal is to merely familiarize you with the concepts and relate them to your everyday experiences in such a way that they make more sense later when you look at OOP design and implementation. The first characteristics of object-oriented programming are the class and objects. These are the core of object-oriented programming. A class is the blueprint or template for its objects, and objects are the instances of a class. Huwag kayong malilito sa class and objects. Each object has its own state, behavior, and identity. From one class, several objects can be created. Each object has similar set of data defined in class, and it can use functions defined in the class for the manipulation of data. In simple language, you can say that in structured programming, you segregate the problem into small functions, and in OOP, you divide the problem into objects. If you are familiar with data types like int, double, float, and so forth, you know that these are built-in data types or primitive data types because they are already defined in computer language. But when you create your own data type, let's say a student, you need to create a student class. Just as when you need to create an integer variable, you mention the int first. Similarly, when you need to create a student object, example, John is a student, you need to mention your student class first. For example, we can create a class car which have properties like company, model, year of manufacture, fuel type, and so on, and which may have actions like acceleration, brake, etc. So, objects are the basic runtime entity in a Java program. All objects are instances of a class. Depending upon type of class, an object may represent anything like a person or mobile, chair, student, employee, book, lecturer, speaker, car, vehicle, or anything which we see in our daily life. The state of an object is determined by the data values they are having at a particular instance. Objects occupy space in memory, and all objects share same set of data items which are defined when class is created. Two objects may communicate with each other through functions by passing messages. In layman's term, animal can be stated as a class, and lion, tiger, elephant, wolf, cow, etc. are its object. Another example, Bird can be stated as a class, and sparrow, eagle, hawk, pigeon, etc. are its object. And lastly, singer can be stated as a class. An example of objects under singer class are Sarah G, Gary V, and Bamboo. So that is class and object. Let us now proceed to abstraction. The key purpose of abstraction is to show only the essential features and to hide the background details of implementation. Abstraction is also very much related to encapsulation, but the difference may be easily understood with a simple day-to-day scenario. When you press a button on your remote control to switch on the TV, we do not care about the internal circuits of the TV o kung paano yung remote control controls the operation ng TV natin. We simple know yung mga iba't ibang button sa keypad ng remote control natin na iba-iba ang kani-kanilang functions. At as long as gumagana, masaya na tayo, hindi ba? So, the user is isolated from the complex implementation details which are encapsulated within the remote control. At the same time, the common operations that can be performed through the remote control can be thought of as an abstraction. Another important feature of OOP is encapsulation. Encapsulation is the mechanism that binds together functions and data in one compact form known as class. The data and functions may be private or public. Private data or functions can only be accessed only within the class. Public, the data and code can be accessed outside the class. The use of encapsulation hides complexity from the implementation. Linking of function code and data together gives rise to objects which are variables of type class. Example of encapsulation is the HR department. The HR staff encapsulated or hide the information of the employees in their organization. It is because of the privacy, and they determine how this data can be used and manipulated. Any request for the employees' data or update ay kailangan dadaan sa kanila. That is encapsulation. Next is polymorphism. Poly means many and morph means form. So polymorphism means more than one form. Thus, polymorphism provides a way for an entity to behave in several forms. In layman's term, an excellent example of polymorphism is Lord Krishna in Hindu methodology. From programmer's point of view, polymorphism means one interface, many methods. Another example, could train my dog to respond to the command bark and my bird to respond the command chirp. On the other hand, I could train them to both respond to the command speak. Through polymorphism, I know that the dog will respond with a bark and the bird will respond with a chirp. Next, we have inheritance. Inheritance is the mechanism of driving a new class from the earlier existing class. The inheritance provides the basic idea of reusability in object-oriented programming. The new class inherits the features of the old class. The old class and new class is called base, derive, parent, child, super, and sub. The inheritance supports the idea of classification. In classification, we can form hierarchies of different classes, each of which having some special characteristics beside some common properties. Through classification, a class need only definition those qualities that make it unique within its class. As an example, at the topmost in the hierarchy, we can have a vehicle class. All the common features of a vehicle can be put in this class. From this, we can drive a new class, say, two-wheeler, which contains features specific to two-wheeler vehicles only. As another example, we can example of an engineering college as the top class with its subclass, its various departments like civil, mechanical, electrical, etc. Again, the engineering college may have its parent class as the university to which it is affiliated. And last characteristics of OOP is the aggregation. It is identified by the phrase "is a part of," as with a product that contains parts. If neither of the first two relationship applies, but the objects are clearly related. For example, an employee is associated with a company. Then the relationship is association. So that is the characteristics of OOP. And I have included here the things you need to remember when you talk about the object-oriented programming. The key features of OOP are the encapsulation, abstraction, inheritance, polymorphism, and aggregation. Number two, you need to remember or what is the differences of class and objects. So, objects are made from a class. An object is an instance of a class, which is just a template or blueprint of your object. Class is a logical entity while object is a physical entity. A physical entity can be allocate memory in system while logical does not. Next, how about abstraction and encapsulation? Abstraction naman focuses on the noticeable behavior of an object and encapsulation focuses on the implementation part of that behavior. Encapsulation helps you to bundle your data and at the same time, it can hide some information that you do not want to disclose to the outside world. And lastly, some important characteristics of OOP are your focus is on data, not on functions. So you divide your program into objects, not function. You do not allow data to flow freely, so you use methods to access them. Your objects communicate through methods, and the outside world should not access your data. Lastly, your application can adapt to new changes easily, and at the same time, it is easy to maintain. I want to thank you for watching this video and the whole lesson. I hope this was helpful for you. Please like and subscribe for more upcoming videos. And I will see you next time. Bye-bye!